Hi, everybody. Welcome to Framework Leadership, a podcast about principles and ideas you can use today to take your leadership to the next level. And we are now exclusively a part of the SCU Podcast Network. I'm your host, Ken Engel, president of Southeastern University.
And I'm your co-host, Michael Steiner, SCU chief of staff.
And we are excited today to announce our guest on our show, Michael Moe. Michael is the founder and CEO of GSV Holdings, a growth-focused investment platform based in Silicon Valley. He was also named Best on the Street by the Wall Street Journal while heading global growth research and has worked as a leader and advisor within several different investment committees. Michael, wow, it's an honor to welcome you to the show today.
Hey, Ken. Hey, Michael. It's great to be with you.
Hey, on today's episode, I want us to talk about the power of education and investment. And you've learned the importance of business over the last several years and how hard work pays off. Over the years, you've invested in various education companies. What motivated you to pursue these specific types of investments?
Yeah, so we invest in high growth, high opportunity businesses. And so we invest in companies like Facebook and Twitter and Dropbox, Spotify and Snap and a bunch of companies like that. But education has been a particular focus of ours because we believe that it represents tremendous opportunity. Why? First of all, you know, first thesis in a global marketplace and knowledge-based economy, what you know, your education makes a difference for an individual, for a company, and for that matter, a country. And so the classic investment opportunity is where there's a problem. The bigger the problem, the greater the opportunity. Mm-hmm. Well, in this knowledge-based economy, how people more effectively get their education and what type of return they get on that education, I don't think there's a bigger issue that faces society or a greater opportunity. Therefore, it's a recipe for tremendous opportunity investment.
So what are you guys seeing as some of the major trends happening in education today as you're looking kind of towards the future and where everything's going, especially in kind of this post-pandemic where there's a little bit of a moratorium on online? It wasn't as successful in some ways as people were hoping it was going to be, but it was very successful in other ways. What are some of the trends and directions you're seeing?
Well, first of all, online, you know, it's going to be an ongoing evolution. But the opportunity with online is democratizing learning, increasing access, lowering the cost, and ultimately improving quality. In terms of trends or themes, you know, a couple themes. One is this idea of lifelong learning. So it used to be that you played from 0 to 5, you learned from 5 to 25 years old, you worked from 25 to 65, and then you retired. Well, now you're going to be learning from the time essentially you're born to the time you retire, if you ever retire. So you no longer fill up your knowledge tank at age 25 and drive off through life. You're going to continually need to be learning things. Yeah. You're not going to do that in a traditional fashion. You're going to be getting that knowledge, that education, you know, in different ways, on the fly, playing games, you know, and so forth and so on. So that's a major trend. The second is you think about historically, education has been effectively a local physical cottage industry. With digital learning, you're starting to see these models that are rapidly scaling, you know, reach mass audiences. We call those weapons of mass instruction.
Yeah,
so
that's good.
Mass instruction, you know, companies like Coursera, which we are a major, we are a major investor in. That's an example of a company of weapons of mass instruction. And maybe the third trend that I'd mention is this idea, I mean, I guess they're both related. I call it Hollywood meets Harvard. Mm. And that's the idea that if you're not engaged or paying attention, you're not going to learn anything. Mm. What Hollywood does a great job of is telling stories, of being able to create engagement, making stars of actors, and having high quality but low cost through scale. So companies like MasterClass and outlier examples of those companies. And the second kind of sister concept of that, I call it invisible learning. And that's the idea that you're learning without even really recognizing that that's what you're doing. Wow. So, for example, you know, we have nearly 3 billion gamers around the world now. That's up from 50 million 20 years ago. Well, if you can learn things while you're doing something that you're having fun doing, that's a great concept. There was a nice article in the Wall Street Journal this week about a family that basically learned political science during the pandemic through playing Minecraft. So, I mean, those are the kind of things that I guess we're focused on paying attention to.
Yeah. Now, with the rise of so much social media and especially younger generations with an amazing engagement, what do you think is one of the biggest challenges that businesses like Spotify, Twitter, all of them have to understand as they navigate that?
Well, as I think you alluded, you know, there's lots of alternatives, and increasingly there's little friction or switching cost. So you have to have something where you're creating tremendous value, even if it's for free, because, you know, your time is bad. Right. So you just, you know, like just yesterday, Netflix reported that it lost subscribers last quarter. And, you know, I mean, they could talk about competition. They could talk about a lot of things. I think it's because they didn't have as much content that people really wanted to see. And therefore, you know, there was lots of choices, and there's very little cost of switching. So that's something that is a reality. I think it's any business, and particularly when you talk about a subscriber business, but I think it's any business, one of the key concepts is how do you create overwhelming value mm-hmm. for that consumer, that customer. So there's just like how you can't even imagine that this you're getting all this value for $9.99 a month or for $5 a month or $15 a month or free. You're just saying, how does this, you know, and those businesses have very sticky customers, and you see them do things that, you know, that continue to delight their audience. So, you know, Joe Rogan, mm-hmm. you know, with Spotify, I mean, Spotify is just, we were a big investor in Spotify. Yeah. I think Spotify just continues to find ways to add more and more value for their subscribers. You know, like some, there's free, you can be on subscribe, you can be free on Spotify, you can pay for Spotify. They just keep on bringing more and more things that people love, and their business is thriving.
Yeah. You know, and we've talked a lot about this in kind of higher education. What we're seeing is the traditional higher education model was connecting content with personal interaction. So you're lecturing, you're hearing in-person a lecture from a professor, and that's kind of the mode of learning in this side. But I think what you're highlighting a lot is this kind of now ubiquitous divorce of content from the personal interaction, in that I can get access to content anywhere, anytime, as much as I want, anything that I want to, but we still don't have that personal interaction. What is, in your opinion, what does personal interaction in an education context or in any context look more like in a digital age? And how can companies, as they're pushing out content, creating content, also be sure to have that personal connection?
When you talk specifically about education, I think this is where there's a huge white space opportunity. Mm-hmm. What you've seen, I mean, you've seen the different iterations of online learning. And, you know, I think where things are basically at today is high quality content that's more or less still pushed at you, right? It's, mm-hmm. it's one directional. And, you know, it's low cost. You know, they're complementing that with artificial intelligence and some other ways to create value. But you haven't seen the two-way interaction. You haven't seen the communities and the peer-to-peer learning. I think there's a huge opportunity to be creating communities around subject matters, around affinity groups, around things where people are, you know, because we all know, you know, the best way you learn is teaching somebody else.
Right.
When you're sharing and you're participating in something that you're involved with, you're going to learn better. You're going to have stickier, you know, students, and they're going to get better value. And you haven't really seen online providers, platforms that have nailed that. We've invested in some companies that were doing that, and it was, you know, being too early is the same as being wrong.
Yeah. Right.
And so the market wasn't really ready for some of those ideas when they were introduced. I think it is ready now.
Yeah.
I think that's the next chapter here.
Yeah. You know, in early 2020, you founded GSV University and GSV MBA, an accredited graduate program for entrepreneurs. Tell us about this program. What motivated you to establish it and get it going?
Well, as you can probably tell, I have a huge passion towards education. I also have a huge passion towards entrepreneurship. And we've been involved with, you know, with a number of online education businesses. And so what I like to say is that old McDonald had a firm, E-I-E-I-O. Well, new McDonald has a startup, E-I-E-I-O. It's about entrepreneurship, innovation, education, impact, and creating equal opportunity. So that's in the framework that I've had for a while, and believed, in part because of the pandemic, that entrepreneurship was a huge area of opportunity that people were desperate for. And we have skill set and content base and connections that we felt could deliver something that was really valuable. And, you know, just through different relationships I had, we launched the GSV MBA. Mm. We have the GSV Boot Camp, which is, we're actually going through our third cohort as we speak. So we have 3,000 students around the world, you know, with a bunch from India, a bunch from Africa, that are part of this 7-week boot camp that are all, it's free. It's mm-hmm. free for them. And we're doing that because we think it's there's the element of the universe that when you pay something forward, you know, it comes back to you manyfold. And so we're doing that. But the online MBA, we're very excited about. And, you know, we're working hard to create a program that people are, you know, proud to be part of. And we're certainly proud to be running it.
You know, let me ask you this. You get to work with a lot of young entrepreneurs or first start off leaders. Maybe they're not young, but in different startups and even through your MBA program. If there were two or three characteristics that really kind of, as you've seen, set the standard, set the difference between the ones that make it as they push in their entrepreneurial journey versus the ones that don't quite make it, what would those characteristics be?
Yeah, it's a great question because, you know, you see successful entrepreneurs that have different personalities, different backgrounds, a lot of differences. And, you know, but what are the common denominators? One is this positive energy. You don't see entrepreneurs at a startup that don't have positive energy and have the ability to attract people, whether it's, you know, it's other, you know, young new employees or investors or customers. I mean, there's a positive energy that gets people to sort of suspend their disbelief and why all the reasons why something isn't going to work. Mm-hmm. They, you know, that founder has the positive energy, that ability to kind of look ahead and get people to back them. The second, and it sounds corny, but I could tell you story after story after story. In fact, I can't tell you of a company that I've been involved with that doesn't have a version of this story, where you have something that looks like it could be devastating or terminal, and the entrepreneur has the resilience to overcome it and move forward. Because, I mean, in fact, there's a wise saying in Silicon Valley that every great company has nearly, you know, been killed three times.
Wow.
And that's more normal than not. But a lot of people, you know, you have adversity, right, and it's like, you know, the sky is falling, or, you know, they don't have that resilience to kind of to power through it. And the third piece is this idea that you see the great founders have this innate understanding that it's not about them. You know, if they can help their customers get what they want, if they can get the employees get what they want, if they get the investors what they want, they will be successful. It's this idea of kind of almost servant leadership. And, you know, and again, you see examples of founders that have been successful that might be all about them, but those ones typically don't survive. Mm. I mean, they might get often that's a situation where you see a company get to a certain place, and it's usually pretty young in the business.
Right.
Somebody's just like crazy passionate, and, you know, but it's all about how they get rich fast or whatever. And typically those founders get switched out for a professional management team. You see them go on, and those are the characteristics I say. I'd say, you know, one, positive energy. Second, you know, the relentlessness, you know, overcoming adversity. And the third is really this idea that you can get everything you want if you help enough other people get what they want.
Yeah. You know, one of the more important things, I think, for leaders to have is real world experience, on your journey, whether that's in high school, college, first career. How has your personal real world experience contributed to your success?
Well, you know, I think that's an important question. I think that's part of it is to pay attention to what that experience is and how you've been able to apply it to your life journey, your business journey. So, you know, kind of going back to education, one of the reasons I got very interested in education was two experiences I had. You know, I studied a lot of companies. I was a research analyst initially, saw a lot of companies. I went and visited a school in Baltimore, Maryland, and I grew up in Minneapolis. Public schools, public college, blah, blah, blah. I went to this school in Baltimore. I couldn't believe the school existed in the United States of America. I mean, we had dead pets in the courtyard that neighbors had shot for sport, no partitions in the bathrooms, security. I mean, it's like you say, like, wow. You wonder why half the kids drop out of school. I said, I can't believe this exists. And so I was like, no, this is, you know, how can America that happen? The second experience is I was at Lehman Brothers. And I kind of fluked in through some lucky companies that I was involved with that were successful early that was running the growth business at Lehman Brothers. And so I had to hire a team to work with me. Well, I realized there I couldn't hire anybody to work for me that had my background. Because I went to University of Minnesota, to work at Lehman Brothers, you had to go to one of five Ivy League schools. You had to have this kind of pedigree. I said, this is absurd. I mean, I thought going to the University of Minnesota was a great school. And I had a lot of smart people that went there with me and so forth. And I couldn't hire somebody to have my background. So this is nuts. And so those two things I would say, were very influential why I got involved in education. I guess the third thing I just quickly mentioned, because I do think it definitely has influenced me significantly, as I played team sports my whole life, or at least until I got to be an adult. So it's hard to do as an adult, but I played college football and I played basketball and baseball growing up. And being on a team, does teach you a lot of things, I think, that you could apply to life. It's, how do you work with others? Right. How do you overcome obstacles? How do you have a goal for, one for all for one? And I think that certainly influenced me as it related to both culture of businesses that I was involved with, as well as businesses that I wanted to be investors in.
You've served as an advisor and board member on several committees over the years, and in your time with these organizations, what have you noticed are the best qualities for leaders to have when holding positions of importance and authority and influence?
So I think the most important thing a leader can do is to listen, and not be a dictator. At some point, the leader needs to lead, but to get full participation, and certainly from a management group and a board of directors, you, instead of telling, you want to be listening, because that's really, really, you see the best ones. That's what they do. A second piece is this. And it kind of is related to the first, but it's a little bit different, is to really understand people as people, because, I think there's a lot of, I think you see mediocre leaders or mediocre companies where, CEO is about, setting goals and how are you doing versus how are you doing on your OKRs or, KPIs or whatever the metric you're using. And it's not like, how are you doing? How's your family? Are your kids okay? How was that vacation you just were on? I mean, you look at the leaders that the companies where they take a second to actually understand you as a person, it just creates a whole different dynamic. And yeah. I think you see that in the most successful companies. I've had the fortune to have, as you said, been a number of successful boards and non-successful boards. I think the person who influenced me tremendously was a guy named Bill Campbell, who sadly died 5 years ago. They call him the coach of Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. And because they call him the coach of Silicon Valley because he was the coach for Steve Jobs. He was the coach for Eric Schmidt at Google. And he was the coach of Jeff Bezos and a bunch of people he was the coach for. He was a good friend of mine, luckily. And one of the things that he said is, your title on your card, says you're the CEO or whatever, but your people make you the leader. Yeah. You can't be the leader because of your title. You become the leader by what you do to show leadership. And he has some other great principles, but that was something that you see in great leaders, that it's not the title that makes them, in charge, or makes people follow them. It's what they do, who they are. I guess the last thing is consistency. Mm-hmm. You see people that are kind of mercurial, and today they say paint the wall white, and everybody, because of the CEO, everybody paints the wall white. Well, 3 days later, they come back and say, why is the wall white? It should be green. And at some point, people just quit paying attention.
Right.
And so that kind of consistency and that creating that North Star, that's another characteristic that is important.
Let me ask you this, kind of as we wrap up and kind of before we head into the fire round, what are some of the companies you've seen, especially this past year during the pandemic, that have done it well? Maybe companies, maybe CEOs, the couple that comes to mind that have really kind of lived out what you're talking about here well.
Yeah. So, Coursera has absolutely killed it. Yep. Jeff Magical, the CEO, has done a tremendous job leading an organization that was going through dynamic, breakneck growth, great job of communication and setting standards, and just, you know, really, you know, impressive in terms of what he did. Dan Rosenzweig, mm-hmm. who's the CEO of Chegg.
Yeah.
You know, again, experienced this huge acceleration of growth, and everybody's, you know, they got all sorts of issues you're dealing with. And you think about it, you run this company. So first of all, the company's growing really fast.
Right.
But all this pressure amongst your customers and the ecosystem. And then everybody has their own personal issues. I mean, you know, now all of a sudden your kids are home, or you got different, you know, health or school, all these things are going on. And so, the, you know, to manage during that type of period and well, I think is super impressive. I'll give you one. The third, which is a company that I got to know well, is Forbes. It's Mike Federle,
yeah,
the CEO of Forbes. You know, there's all, you think of Forbes have been around 100 years. I mean, everybody has all these challenges. He does a remarkable job of running a business in the environment that that, you know, was really challenging as a CEO, a leader of an organization. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, as we close out our conversation today, we always like to close with a fire round. We ask just a couple of questions surrounding kind of everything we've discussed, and always like you to answer with your quick gut answer. And these are going to be very practical and applicable to the lives of our listeners. So let's begin. Michael, give us the first question.
Yeah. So really want to kind of go back to something you were talking about earlier as far as characteristics that leaders have is that resilience. And in your opinion, how can a leader build and build up their resilience in their life?
It's just never quitting. It's you know, I think there's, you know, the story of burning the boats.
Yeah.
You know, if you always have a way out, a lot of people build their life around what's option B, what's option C. Wow. You know, if this doesn't work out, I think the ones that really overcome all obstacles and adversity, there's one plan, and that plan is to be successful.
Yeah. You know? No, that's good. That's good. What do you consider one of the biggest keys to success?
I think one, be a lifelong learner. Yeah. I mean, secondly, is to be a positive thinker and being optimistic. It's hard to imagine. I can't think of anybody who's achieved success, and you can say, "What's how do you define success?" But it hasn't been positive and, you know, looking for, you know, the good. And frankly, I think people having purpose, you know, in their life in terms of what they're doing. Again, purpose is, means that their life has meaning. I think is a core aspect of success.
Love it. Love it. And last one, and I got to ask this one, it just because of the seat that you sit in, and this is obviously not supposed to be advice, but in your opinion, what's the best opportunity on the market today? As people are just looking and they're kind of looking for spots to look at, what would be the direction, the areas you would say, hey, look here, look down in this area?
Well, first, I think the best thing to invest in is yourself.
Yeah.
Because that's, there's no question that is going to create the greatest return over time. The second investment in terms of just specific ideas or opportunities, you know, we have talked about digital learning, but digital learning is, you know, learning as a market industry is $7 trillion globally.
Yep.
That's nearly 10% of global GDP. And now it's going through all this change. And so this idea of, you know, the companies that truly create a solution to students that are looking to improve their opportunities to continue to be productive and succeed, the ones that meet that need, you know, I mean, you're a huge market, huge need, huge opportunity. And so there's a bunch of really interesting companies with great entrepreneurs running them. So that's where I'd be looking.
Yeah, awesome. That's good. Well, Michael, I want to thank you for joining us today on Framework Leadership Podcast. Grateful for your insight that you have provided us and all of our listeners today.
Ken, Michael, great to be with you. Thank you.
Love having you. And you know, if you want to stay up to date with Michael, you can follow him on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter at Michael Moe. And if you're with us on YouTube right now, as you're watching it and you love the leadership content, please give us that like, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss out on any future Framework Leadership episodes. You can also check out bite-sized leadership content on Instagram, Kent_Engel, or Twitter, KentEngel.com. You can also subscribe to our weekly newsletter, KentEngel.com. Thank you so much for listening to Framework Leadership.
Take care, everybody.